MOM Radio and Pipe Bomb Radio present Not Your Mama's Radio Show with your hosts, former WWE superstars Oscar, Sir Mo, and Dreamy Mimi.
Welcome, everybody, to Nacho Mama's Radio Show. Here is your host, Oscar and Dreamy Mimi.
What up, Felix?
How's it going, man? We've already got callers waiting on hold.
Okay. Oh, we got
No, that's a good thing. I'm doing good otherwise. How are you and Mimi doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing, Mimi?
I'm doing good.
I can't see you.
Yeah.
All right, Felix, first tell us the camp transformation thing. How much weight have you lost up to now?
Well, I've been going strong 6 months now and been down 75 pounds. I've been going to the gym 2 to 3 hours a day and sticking with my diet.
That's
I mean, got to keep going forward. I can't go backwards.
75 pounds. That's all.
What about your weight
awesome.
Size?
Yeah.
What about your waist size? Does your waist size shrink too?
It has definitely shrank, let me tell you.
Yeah, your whole body shrinks.
You end up fitting into clothes that were tight on you, and you don't know how you're doing it, but you're doing it. So, yep, just got to keep plugging forward.
Okay. All right, well, before we do anything else, we have a ritual here at Not Your Mama's Radio Show. I know we got a show of shows tonight, but we don't break protocol. We are going to kick things off with the news with Dreamy Mimi. So, Dreamy Mimi, take it away.
This is your WWE report for the week of May 31st, 2015. Who would have thought the New Day held on to the tag team titles? During the Elimination Chamber, they beat out 5 other tag teams to keep their reign on top. Will this finally gain them popularity with the fans? I think not. Neville, the man that gravity forgot? Well, all of his high-flying antics paid off as he won his match over Bo Dallas. This rivalry has made its way up from NXT to the main roster. Who knows when it'll end? In keeping with NXT, newcomer Kevin Owens beat John Cena. Now, where will he go from here? I guess we'll have to keep watching to see if this Kevin Owens is a real deal or just happenstance. Feed Me More is the newest chant when talking about the Intercontinental Champion, as Ryback won the Elimination Chamber match against Dolph Ziggler, R-Truth, Mark Henry, Sheamus, and King Barrett. But on Monday Night Raw, it was Big Show stepping up, letting it be known that he will be the one vying to take the Intercontinental title from Ryback. And, well, he did it again. Seth Rollins and the Authority have found a way to keep him on top despite his loss to Dean Ambrose at the Elimination Chamber. And speaking of Ambrose, who took off with the WWE World Champion belt on Sunday night, the Authority opened Monday Night Raw demanding that the Lunatic Fringe return the belt to Rollins immediately. But being informed by Reigns that Dean Ambrose was not in the building, Reigns was pitted in an obstacle course of superstars to retain his place in the Money in the Bank ladder match. In Reigns' final test, he got the pin on Bray Wyatt off a backfired distraction from the Authority that led to Rollins, Kane, and J&J Security jumping Reigns after his win. But to their surprise, Ambrose showed up to battle with his brother. On June 14th at the Money in the Bank pay-per-view, it will be R-Truth, Sheamus, Neville, Reigns, and who knows by Monday how many more names will be added. In WWE, you never know. When it comes to Rusev, as we say here on Not Your Mama's Radio Show, what goes up must come down. And when it goes up quickly, the fall is fast and hard. Rusev debuted taking all comers. He was invincible and gained the U.S. title. And now the title gone, Lana gone, winning streak over, and the U.S. title, all replaced by two crutches and a cast. So, Kevin Owens, let that be a wake-up call. I'm Dreamy Mimi, and this is Not Your Mama's Radio.
Okay, tell us, who, in your opinion, wins Money in the Bank, and are they going to walk around with that briefcase for 300 days?
Nah, not 300 days, but I think Reigns is going to take it.
Reigns is going to take it?
I think so.
You mean not R-Truth?
No, definitely not R-Truth.
What's up with that? Just kidding.
All right.
Honestly, Felix, I just think that they're going to play out this whole thing with the Shield brethren.
Yeah, it's a good possibility. I mean, at
what,
this point,
they're going to get back together.
No,
oh, no.
No, I think that
they've
they're going to
the top stars of the show.
Right, and then like, okay, now Reigns and Ambrose are the ones that are still brothers. So, okay, now they're going to, I think, they're going to let Dean get the title, and then they're going to have Reigns get the contract, and, hey, then now the two of them become rivals. So all of that brothering stuff is over.
Coming to a head at SummerSlam.
But we'll see. We will see.
All right, let's bring our sponsor for the charity in. Let's bring the man in, Glenn Kelly.
Oh,
he is now live. Hey, it's Mr. Kelly.
Hey, how you guys doing?
We're doing all right.
Glenn Kelly, Glenn Kelly Real Estate. It is such a pleasure and an honor, Oscar, for you to put this together. Dreamy Mimi, Sir Mo, thank you so much. What a blast. I can't believe it's actually happening to the biggest radio podcast show of the decade, probably of all time. I'm super excited to be a part of it.
Now,
we're
going to
have the richest man on here as well soon.
Let me bring you guys up to speed. I told you guys last week that June was Legends Month, and I have went overboard. Tonight is the party of all parties. This is the night of too many stars that's on. Felix, Million Dollar Man, he's on hold now?
He is on hold. That's why I said the richest man on air right now.
Oh, well,
is actually
okay,
on hold
without
right
no
now.
Further ado, let's not
actually,
keep
though, Mr. Kelly did say he wanted to speak with Mr. Snuka first.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I have Hall of Famer, icon, legend, real quick. I have Jimmy Superfly Snuka with us on the line right now. Jimmy, how are you?
Oh, he's on the line right now. Okay, well, let's get this together.
Hey, cheers, nice to listen to you guys' voice. And, you know, I'm just loving it. I love the fans. I love everybody in this world.
Thank you very much, Jimmy. I appreciate that. Hey, Jimmy, the event, June 13th, I know you do a lot of charities and whatnot. Eternal Tranquility, big New Jersey-founded organization, founded for principles and beliefs on holistic health, yoga, meditation and whatnot, relaxation techniques. It is an honor to have a Hall of Famer of yourself to be a part of this event, June 13th, noon to 4. Jimmy, it is just, it's an honor to even have you on this show.
Thank you very much, brother. You know, I love it. Like I said, you know, TCB, brother, taking care of business, you know?
Oscar, do you have any questions for Jimmy?
I'm blown away right now. I'm going to ask each guest one simple question because I know we got a lot to do and I know we're hyping the event. What is the single greatest match in your WWF career that you remember, Mr. Snooker? I mean the biggest one.
I think it was one, the one with, in the Madison Square Garden with Don Morocco.
Oh.
Off the top of the cage.
Okay. All right. Yep, fair enough. I remember watching WOR-TV Channel 9 in New York at midnight, and that's
what?
Where I first saw you. That's where I first saw you.
I love it. I love it, brothers.
All right.
I think that ought to be the greatest match of all time. Off the steel cage, the super fly splash. I loved it.
Oh, yeah.
Thank
no, it's got to be.
I have to do that one for this world, bro.
All right. And I know you proud of your, I know you're proud of your daughter, Tamina. How's she doing?
She's doing really well. Thank you very much, brothers. You know, she's doing very good. I just watched her on, you know, yeah, on Raw, and she's doing good.
Okay. All right, we're not going to hold you. I want to thank you for coming on. Go and get some rest, and I'm going to see you next Saturday, okay, brother?
Brother, I'm looking forward to it. I can't wait. I'm all excited. I'm getting goosebumps right now.
All right,
thank you, Jimmy.
I got goosebumps the fact that you're on here.
Thank you, Jimmy. Peace and love, baby. See you June 13th.
Thank you very much. God bless, and I love you guys.
All right. And a rare radio appearance, ladies and gentlemen, in case you don't know, that was the Hall of Fame legend, Jimmy Superfly Snooker. It does. I would say it doesn't get any better than that, but it's going to get better right now because without no further ado, we're going to bring in the million, money, the million-dollar man, my nemesis, Ted DiBiase.
Hey, guys, you know what? I heard somebody on there talking a little bit earlier about their waistline going down. Well, I don't know about your waistline going down, but when the million-dollar man's standing on his wallet, there ain't nobody bigger in the WWE. And
oh,
I am
yeah.
ready for Freddie, brother. I am coming to the Jersey Shore, and I am bringing it. That's right. The million-dollar man can't wait to get down
you
there.
You know... You know what I'm bringing? This is Oscar from Men on a Mission, by the way. You know what
yes,
I'm
sir.
Bringing? I'm bringing that set of Hammond luggage you bought me when Mo and Mabel jumped me, and you said, yeah, I'm going to get Oscar a set of Hammond luggage. Well, I still got that set of Hammond luggage, and I'm bringing it next Saturday.
Oh, yeah, just don't swing it at me.
Yeah. Oh, man. You know, my biggest regret is when I first came in, that's when you were leaving on hiatus, but the fact that we didn't get to go against you and IRS to learn, you know, to really learn, you know, in ring, you know, to get that experience, that was my big – we had some great singles matches with IRS, but – the fact that we didn't get to go against Money, Inc. was one of my biggest, you know, regrets. I remember hugging you at the bar because you were leaving and, you know, you were saying goodbye, but you came back on commentary and brought The Undertaker back. So I got a chance to work with you. But, I mean, we had some good times in the 90s, did we not?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And again, I appreciate those kind words. Yeah, you know, it's one of those deals. You know, when I left the WWF and after SummerSlam in 93, you know, I didn't realize that, you know, I mean, I was leaving because I needed a break. And, you know, it's like I went back to work for Japan, and it was an easier routine. I mean, you fly over there and you get on the bus and you go and you work every night and, you know, but, you know, and every, you know, if you got to live the life in the WWE to appreciate how hard it is. I mean, you get on a plane every day and you fly somewhere, you drive somewhere, and it's just, you know, it gets to you. But I had no idea when I left that, you know, that my career was going to, you know, be coming to an end shortly. I herniated two discs in my neck, you know, my first trip to Japan. And that was it. By December, I was done, you know, in 93. But I mean physically, I hate the fact that I didn't get a chance to work with you guys. People ask me that question, and I'll go, do you ever feel like you want to grab somebody and get back in the ring? And I said, in reality, I had my run, I enjoyed it, but every now and then I'll see somebody that's got the potential. You know, that's the only time when I'll say, golly, man, I wish I could get in the ring with that guy. See what I could do with him or for him. But, no, man, I had a great run, I'm grateful that I had it. And again, wrestling fans are great, and opportunities like this don't come up, so often. But I'm looking forward to coming down to the shore.
Hey, Ted, this is Glenn Kelly. I wanted to tell you that I got you hooked up with Dreams Come True for that day where you're going to be meeting children and adults with physical impairments and disabilities and whatnot and meeting and greeting with them. And I got to tell you, Eternal Tranquility, the whole charity for the whole event focused and sponsored by Glenn Kelly Real Estate, they are ecstatic to have you come out. You came out last year. You were the star of the show. Everybody knows it. Hundreds of people came out to see you. You were the man of the hour. And to have you come out again is just truly, truly iconic. And I want to say thank you.
Oh, hey, you're welcome, buddy. And again, God bless you. I mean, doing things for charities is, I mean, that's what it's about. It's not about what you get out of life. It's what you give. And the more you give, the more will come back to you. And of course, everybody knows I'm a minister now, and I promise I won't start preaching. But, it's a real good thing you're doing, brother, and I'm very happy to be a part of it.
Yes, KD, the answer blew it up.
No, go ahead, Dreamy.
I was going to say, I didn't know that you were a minister now, but that actually kind of, confirms what I've seen of you over the last few times that I was in your presence. And I was just thinking about just how humble and just what a nice guy all around you were at these different events with my interaction with you and even watching other people around you, from watching you in the airport to watching you at the different events that we've been at together.
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate that. Really, really do. That's awesome.
I just got one big question I want to ask, and I'm going to let you hype the event and go, because I know you're busy. I want to see if my memory is good. Were you not the first Intercontinental Champion in WWE? Didn't you actually bring that belt into the promotion?
Well,
no, he brought the $1 million belt.
Well, when I came to the WWE the very first time, it was 1979, and Vince McMahon Sr. actually brought me in and called me the North American Heavyweight Champion. Up until that time, the only titles in the WWE were the World Title, the World Tag Team Titles, and the World Ladies Championship.
Yeah.
So it's the first new championship. And I mentioned to Vince one day that, I said, Bill Watts down in Mid-South Wrestling, his champion, he calls the North American Champion. And apparently, Vince wasn't aware of that, Vince Sr. And so when Pat Patterson came in, and of course I'm a young guy. It's my first time up there, and I'm having a good run. But so to get Pat Patterson ready to work with, who was the champion then? I'm brain dead. Who was the champion? That just drives me crazy. I went blank.
Okay.
Anyway. Right. I dropped the title. I dropped the North American title to Pat Patterson to get him ready to work with the champ. And then after he had his run with the champ, we went back around and had return matches. But back to the whole thing about the belt was, what Vince Sr. did was he basically made up a story. He said Pat Patterson went off to a wrestling tournament in Rio de Janeiro, and all the champions that entered to the contest put up their titles, and whoever won the tournament would come out the Intercontinental Champion, and Patterson won it. So that's how they renamed the belt. So, in reality, I guess you would say, yeah, I was the first Intercontinental Champion, but it was the North American Champion, and then they changed the name of the belt.
Okay, yeah,
Bob
you know
Backlund.
What?
I'm sorry, that was a, he was getting ready to wrestle Bob Backlund.
Okay, yeah, no, I've been one because it drove me. I know it because I actually would watch WOR TV midnight on Saturday, and I was watching with my stepdad, and I remember your first television match then, and I remember you having that belt, but I wanted to make sure that, you know, and I bring it up because it was just an honor to watch you on TV when I was younger with my stepdad, then actually transition to actually work with you, be a friend of yours, be in your presence, and make history with you. And next Saturday, I can't wait to see you again, man. I want to just thank you for everything.
Hey, brother, you know what? I that's the thing about this business. It's really a brotherhood. I mean, and it's one of those things where we share a unique lifestyle. In other words, unless people have done this and have been on the road, and they, you know, it's hard to explain to them. You know, and I tell people all the time. They say, "Well, do you keep in touch with a lot of guys?" And I said, "Well, you know, the way it is with wrestling. I mean, you know, you might be with some guys for 2 or 3 months or a year, and then all of a sudden this guy's got to go, and he's gone, and you don't see him for, you might not see him for 6 months, you might not see him for a year, but the next time you see him, it's like you saw him yesterday."
Yeah.
And you just pick right back up where you were, and you just keep going. And so, yeah, man, I'm looking forward to coming down and seeing you guys as well. It's just been a long time. And,
yeah, it has.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of guys here, man. I mean, Jake's going to be there, right? And,
yeah.
DDP there.
We actually have a huge lineup. We have a huge lineup, Ted. We got Kurt Angle, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Tatanka, Tito Santana, Jake, yourself, Sonny, Lita,
wow.
Superfly,
wow.
Paul Mahoney. This is like iconic.
It's like a who's who, man.
Yeah, this is. But you know, the $1 million man, he's going to take precedence. He always does when he starts flashing the $100 bills like he did last year. He was the man.
You know, people ask me all the time. They said, "Did you really give all that money away?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "But it wasn't my money. It was business money."
It was Glenn Kelly Real Estate's money. He was giving it away, nothing like.
Whose idea was that when you came in? Did you collaborate with Vince with that, or did he make that up?
No, I mean, when I came in, they called me in, and they basically, Vince said, "I've got an idea." So it was Vince's personal idea. And he said, "You know, I've watched you work as a heel, and the way you carry yourself and everything," and he said, "You know, you're perfect for this." And so as we were talking, he got called out to a call, and Pat Patterson, who was Vince's right-hand man, was sitting there, and he looked at me, and he said, "Ted," he said, "here's all you need to know. This is Vince's personal idea. In other words, if Vince were going to put the tights on and climb in the ring, this is who he would be."
Okay.
He said, "This is like his alter ego. He says he's going to push this thing hard." That's all I needed to hear. The rest is history.
Hey, guys, I just want to let you know that Sir Mo is actually on air with us as well.
Cool.
Just
hey, Mo,
you know,
what's up, man?
Hey, guys, how's everybody doing?
Pretty good.
All right. We got our man Ted DiBiase on with us right now, Mo.
Well, that means that somebody's going to get a check today, so I'm glad I came on board.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, yeah, you know, I wouldn't lie to you. Check's always in the mail, right?
I always got mine.
I remember one night we couldn't get a draw because Arnold Scola, the one who gave out all the draws, said, "Well, we got to wait for the $1 million man to come back and give us a loan. He's got the money down there, all with the briefcase out the ring. So we got to wait for the other cigar in his mouth. We got to wait for Ted to come. Ted's going to give us a loan, and I'm going to give you the draw."
Oh, yeah. Arnold Scola, he was a classic, too.
Oh, yeah.
Always had that cigar butt in his mouth.
Exactly, most definitely. All right, man, we're going to let you go ahead and roll. I know you got a lot to do. Hey, I know you're going to say something.
Yeah, guys, and hey, listen, hey, great talking to you. And, you know, I just, you know, to all the fans who might be listening, You know, like, come on out, man. It's going to be, I mean, I can't wait for this because I'm going to see a lot of guys that I don't see on a regular basis. You know, you mentioned Tito Santana. Tito and I, you know, Tito and I played college football together in West Texas State.
I didn't know that.
And when we came to New, we both came to New York together at the same time.
Okay.
And so, you know, there's a guy that I've known that guy ever since college. So, man, just a lot of guys coming, and I'm just looking forward to it.
I think I might have made that dream come true.
Just one last thing before I go.
Uh-huh.
Just remember, everybody's got a price for the $1 million man.
Ah, there you go. Money. All right, thanks a lot, Ted. That was fantastic. Now, Dreamy, you ran into DiBiase. What was your impression of him? He was a real nice guy, huh?
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, even seeing him interact with other people, we were in the airport, and that was before we got to one of the events, and I was just watching him, just like I said, interacting with everybody around, and he was just such a humble guy and just a really nice guy. And then even at the event.
Well, you know what? It's an idea. We're gonna get him. We're gonna really follow up with him in the next few weeks because it might be a good idea for you guys to actually talk collaborative ministry. Find out what he's doing. He find out what you're doing. Exchange ideas and then maybe come together on something. All in God's plan.
Sounds good to me.
All right, so fresh back from Canada, we got to get Sir Mo in here for a minute to find out what's been happening. The prodigal son has returned. How you doing, man?
Hey, man, what's going on? I'm recovering from food poisoning, man.
Yeah, see, that jig's dinner got the jig's dinner got your ass, huh?
Nah, I think it was the vegetable beef soup, though, bro. I stayed away from the jig dinner.
Yeah, the vegetable soup was the jig's vegetable soup. So it was all the, they was trying to get rid of your black ass, huh?
And they put some pork in it. That's what it was.
There you go. Yeah. That you're not used to that Canadian pork.
No, not at all. Not at all.
All right. Felix, we got anybody else in the queue right now?
No, we actually just have fans on hold with questions for upcoming guests, if they're comfortable taking them, of course. Otherwise, no, we are just waiting for the next person to call in.
All right, so Glenn, eternal tranquility, explain exactly what that is. What are we getting ourselves into?
Okay, so it's the biggest, just like tonight, the biggest podcast radio show in history, surpassing even Stone Cold Steve Austin. That's right, I said it. Right here, I'm on a mission. It's Eternal Tranquility. It's a New Jersey organization founded on principles and beliefs that all humanity is one family and you are to be kept at optimal health via yoga, meditation, holistic nutrition, and relaxation. Now,
okay. They
have come up with a program called Dreams Come True. And that program helps children and adults with physical impairments and disabilities to actually meet celebrities and whatnot, and that's sort of like we're granting a wish, a.k.a. a dream to them. And all the wrestlers are coming out, including yourself. These kids and adults are like in another world to be able to say that they're going to meet the TNA heavyweight champion Kurt Angle, Lita, you know, Sunny. They're like in another galaxy to be able to say that they did that. And, you know, me as the owner of the sponsor, the sole sponsor who's putting the whole gig together, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, it's an honor and a tribute to me to give back to the community. We do a lot of charity, as you know, Oscar. And to put something like this together, it's just, it is beyond enormous. There's nothing of this magnitude. An event like this, you're talking $40,000 to try to throw something like this off. And when it comes together like this, when you have ultimate people, like just like with Ted and whatnot, you got icons joining you to come out and sign autographs and take pictures for fans and whatnot on June 13th. It's going to be unbelievable. And the venue, the Beachcomber Bar and Grill in Seaside Heights, Saturday, June 13th, noon to 4. We are broadcasting live, not only on 5 podcasts, including your own, but we're also broadcasting live on New Jersey's biggest radio show, B98.5 Radio, live for 4 hours. I mean, it's just going to be, it's going to be a beautiful day. The weather's calling beautiful. And I expect thousands to turn out for this event. It's going to be amazing.
Hey, guys.
Okay.
I just want to let you know, and my mistake, I did come across Jake online here. That was my mistake. I will bring him on now, the one and only, the legendary Jake the Snake Roberts.
Hey, guys. I've been listening to DiBiase rant for about 20 minutes. My God, he
Hey. Well, it's your turn now. Well, we far be it from us to make a guy with an eight-foot python wait for anything. What's happening, baby?
You guys left me hanging, man. That's okay. I'm going to show up anyway just to get even with you.
Well, you're here now. I'm just going to call you Mr. Roberts.
Mr. Roberts, how
you doing, man?
I'm doing absolutely fabulous, man. I couldn't be happier. Clean and sober now 3 years, man. And had I known that getting sober was going to feel this good, I'd done a long time ago, man. I got my family all back together. My life is just a bowl of cherries, you know. So,
my big question for you, how did you like that five-hour torture chamber we were in Las Vegas with those matches at Cauliflower Alley that went on to the next morning?
I walked out. I couldn't take it. I'd rather be in a dentist office here having my teeth pulled. Are you kidding me? Brutal, man. You know, it's one thing when they're good matches, but it's another thing when they're not.
They all could have been. That's
what happens these days, man. These independent guys, these guys that are struggling or whatever, trying to get something going, they think a longer show is a good show. That's wrong. The proper time for a show should be about an hour and 45 minutes, man. Get those people in there, show them a good time. Get them on down the road. They got kids to take care of. But, you know, you get these young guys out there, and they see some people out in the audience. They go, oh, man, I got to do everything I know, you know. God almighty.
Yeah.
That's part of it, man. God bless you. I can't do all that stuff anymore, man. I don't want to either.
I hear you, man. I understand. Give us one good, be asking everybody one good story to have them hype the event. Because we know that you guys got things to do, but we're not holding y'all long tonight. Give us one good road story.
Good road. Wrestling with Andre was unbelievable for me.
Okay.
I just never believed that I actually be in the ring. And as far as, you know, here's some news, folks. Andre wasn't afraid of no damn snake, okay? Give me a break. how lucky he didn't shove it up my rear end, but... One night I was wrestling him up in Montreal, man, and he knocked me on my butt, and he sat on me, and I turned to my side so he wouldn't break my sternum, and all of a sudden my shoulder starts vibrating, and I don't know what the hell's going on. And David Hedman, the referee, walked over and said, Andre, why are you laughing? He said, I'm 14. And, he ripped off about 30 seconds on my shoulder, man. When I got up, I had like a wine stain on my shoulder, like a birthmark.
Oh, my goodness. That is
yeah, it was good
much.
Time, man. God bless you, man. There's so many guys that are gone. It's going to be so much fun for guys like myself and the other guys, man, to get back in touch with each other, see each other again. Because, man, we lost another one just a couple of days ago. Tommy Rogers, man. Just unbelievable, man. It seems like there's always somebody falling off this old planet. And I'm just grateful to God and everything else, man, that's going on in my life. And I was able to come through the other side with the drug and alcohol addiction, finally beat that. It's a daily process, but, you know, I feel great. I mean, I really feel great. I feel better than ever. I was 40 years old. And I just turned 60. So look out. You know, I'm ready to hit the ring.
All right, Glenn, I know you want to thank Jake in advance for next Saturday, so go ahead.
Hey, Jake, I just want to say it is my honor and privilege to have you come out to the show for Glenn Kelly Real Estate. It's going to be an honor. Everybody is hyped up. I don't know if you've seen it online. I follow you online.
Oh, yeah.
And once I posted that you, Ted, Kurt, Lita, everyone's coming on the show tonight for this giant charity event coming on this show, we got over 10,000 likes in less than 48 hours, which just stands as a testament that you are iconic. You know, Ted, iconic. You guys really are the cream of the crop. You know Glenn Kelly's going to treat you like you are royalty when you come on out here.
I appreciate that very much. There's really not a need for it, man. I just want to get out there and help somebody else, man, because it's like
beautiful.
You said, man, you got to give
and
it back, man.
And that's what eternal tranquility is all about. Beautiful.
Yeah. All right, you guys take care, man. I'm going to get off here. I got some things to do, and we'll see you soon.
All right, Jake. Thanks a lot, my man.
All right, bye-bye.
Hey, guys, I just want to let you know that we do have Hacksaw Jim Duggan online. I'm going to go ahead and bring him on. If you guys we're ready for him. All right.
Hey!
All right, Hacksaw, you're on live, sir.
Well, hey, fellas, if you're going to hole, you got a hole like you mean it. Let's go. Hello.
There you go.
There you go. Kind of gets old Hacksaw ready to go. You know, gets the hair standing up. It gets old air in the lungs. Gets old Hacksaw fired up, even at this stage.
That whole thing with the 2x4, whose idea was that and how did that come about?
Well, you know, back in the old days, it was a much rougher business. You know, I was a bad guy out in West Texas, and just getting back and forth from the ring was a challenge. You know, the people, they kick you, they spit on you, they punch you. And I'm sitting in the back of the dressing room all covered in bruises and loogies from people. And Bruiser Brody came up to me and he says, Duggan, he said, if you carry something into the ring, carry something you can use. Forget those feathered boas and sequin robes. And I'm like, well, there's a piece of wood. And I came out yelling, waving that wood. It was like parting the Red Sea. Those people scattered. I got back and forth to the ring without a problem, so I've been carrying it ever since. Comes in handy.
Oh, okay. Well, there's a story. I got to apologize and say thank you at the same time for an incident, and I never forget it. It was in Wilton, Connecticut, where I had just got finished doing a match with Mo and Mabel, and they had told me, and I was too excited because it was the first WWF magazine I had a picture in. So the guy said, I give you a bunch of them. So he was at the announce table. I come running down the ring a year in a match. I didn't know no better. I was so green and was so pathetic. I went down there, and you stopped in the middle of what you was doing and looked like, what the hell? Why the hell is Oscar doing the running on my match? I did not know no better. But you got out the ring, and you was like, we were all green a little once. J.J. Dillon was hot. He was hot, but you just took it in stride, and I want to thank you and apologize at the same time. I'll never forget that, but that is one funny story. But your career is iconic, and right now Glenn Kelly is on the line now to thank you in advance for your participant in the charity event next Saturday. Take it away, Glenn.
Hacksaw, it is an honor and a privilege, my friend. We've been talking back and forth. It is a privilege for myself to bring you out to this event. It is June 13th, noon to 4, Beachcomber Bar and Grill. Huge, unbelievable venue, and it seems fitting, you know, overlooking the oceanfront for all you superstars and icons. Like I said, I can't say much, but just thank you so much for coming out for Eternal Tranquility and all the kids that are going to be there for the Dreams Come True program. It is a true honor and a privilege to have you come out. And my company, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, sponsoring the event, is just in another galaxy to be able to say that we're affiliated with the big man, Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Well, thanks, Glenn. I'll tell you, you know, wrestling, we do an awful lot of charity work at all different types of charities, and we're all excited to be part of this event. And, you know, it's great for us also. You know, I just heard you talking with Jake the Snake. You know, Jake was the head usher in my wedding 26 years ago.
Wow.
Was DiBiase. I wrestled Teddy thousands of times all over the world. So it's going to be like old home week for us to get together and visit a little bit. And, of course, it's a great opportunity to
say hello to the fans, tell them thanks for all the years of support, get some autographs, get some pictures, get everybody in the place going, hey, USA!
USA!
So, have fun with it, you know?
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Well, I love it, man. We're going to have a blast. Yeah, it's going to be fun.
I'm sure there'll be plenty of 2x4s ready.
Well, like I tell you, that's like I used to travel with Jake, and I used to walk into an arena. I said, "Could somebody find me a 2x4 and find him a 10-foot python?" You know, walking around with a, you know, just that was a lot easier not having to carry something to eat or went to the bathroom. You know, Coco with a bird, Jake with a snake, Bulldogs with a dog. I was happy with my 2x4.
Well, I mean, it's going to be an honor to have you there. This is shaping up to be a family reunion. Thank you for coming on, and we're going to see you next Saturday.
Well, my pleasure, brother. Looking forward to it. Oscar, you know what we got to do before we hang up, brother? Let's make a big O. Here we go, baby. Hey!
Hey!
That's a pretty good O, man.
All right, well, hey.
Take care, brother.
Thank you.
Now, before we do anything else, Dreamy Mimi, we just had Jake the Snake on. Didn't y'all have a little flirtations going on out there in Las Vegas? Yeah, I saw you.
Whatever, Oscar. I took a picture with the man.
Yeah. I looked over the corner of my eye.
Oh,
and
look
Jake,
at you. Okay, you
Jake,
know what? The instigating is not necessary. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was
right.
Hey, I can read
lips. I just said, I wasn't instigating.
He was like, hey, chocolate sexy. She was like, hey, Jake. He was like, how you doing? He was like, fine. Who you here? I can read lips. Who you here with? Well, I'm here with Oscar, but Jake, it is so good. How big is that python? You want to see my python? Yeah, I can read lips.
Felix, do you believe this nonsense?
Yeah, I do. But you know what? That's everyday life. So I commend you for putting up with it. I'm kidding.
Right. And look, you hear Mo in the background.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just waiting for those two to go at it.
He's just so wrong because
Wait, no. Do that again. I never heard you speechless. What?
No, I'm just saying he's just wrong.
I've heard a speechless before.
You just wrong.
All right.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Yeah. Hey, Glenn Kelly, just to bring you up to speed. Yeah, Jake the Snake was flirting with my wife at Cauliflower Alley.
I don't believe it.
Thank you, Glenn.
I'm looking at him, he's flirting in a chair, got his neck all stuck out. He's just a cheesing. I'm like, what the hell is going on over there? Snake or smoke snake, I wrestle with legendary ass.
Oh, my goodness. Look, you and yourself trying to put yourself never mind.
Okay, but on a serious note, here's a question that you could ask me.
Uh-huh.
Here's a question you could ask. We're going to have Lita coming on later on tonight, and I would love for you to ask her to compare her style of being a woman in the WWE to the divas of today. See, Lita's Trish Stratus, Deborah Michelli, Alundra Blaze, those are female wrestlers. Today we have divas, so ask her to explain the difference. That should be a really good question and a really good conversation because we're always talking about it.
That's an excellent question.
Oh, sure, there you go.
You're the one to ask.
Okay.
Yeah. No pressure, Mimi. No pressure.
Oh, I'm sorry. You were talking to me?
Yeah.
I didn't hear anything you just said.
She was starstruck by that pot dog.
Oh,
ouch.
Oh, wow. See, I'm so out. I'm so through with you guys today.
Oh, my God. It's going to be an interesting show next week on the Jersey Shore, I can tell you. Y'all are going to have way too much fun. I don't know if y'all are going to want to come back home.
Yeah, no, it's going to be, it's going to be the warp shore. We're going to have a good time.
I'm going to have to get you out here early because I haven't even mentioned yet about the freebies that are going to be given away at the show. So not only does everybody have an opportunity to meet all you superstar icons, but we have over $5,000 worth of freebies that we're giving away to people. So people listening right now, when you come out to meet your favorite stars and whatnot, you literally have a chance to put your name in to win free stuff, over $5,000 worth of free merchandise and gift certificates and memberships.
We are going to discuss that tonight at exactly 10:05, so just hold your britches. We're going to make that happen. All right, so while we got some time, Dreamy, how come R-Truth is not going to get the Money in the Bank contract?
Actually, I want to know what you asked me to do.
Okay. We have Lita coming on in a little while, Hall of Famer and one of the most famous female wrestlers of all time, Lita. So I want you to ask Lita in her opinion, the difference between her as a female wrestler, her and Trish Stratus and so forth and so on, the comparison to what they do as comparison to what the Divas do today. It's a big fundamental difference, and I'm sure she's going to have something to say about it, but I want you to be the one to ask her.
Hey, guys. I just want to let you know, we now can officially say this is the first time ever Not Your Mama's Radio Show debuts the only Olympic gold medalist to be a multi-time world heavyweight champion, current TNA champion.
It's true.
It's true.
I keep saying it's true. Is Kurt Angle really on the phone?
Yes, I am. How you guys doing?
I'm all right, Mr. Angle. How you doing, man?
I'm doing well, thank you.
Wait, where do we begin? Kurt, tell us about how you got into the Olympics. We're not going to keep you long, but there's so much to talk to you about. How you got into the Olympics? What was the feeling to walk around with the Olympians, and how did you feel winning a gold medal? Let's start there before we even get into wrestling.
You know, it's I knew when I was very young that I was going to do something really incredible, and I picked wrestling because my four older brothers all wrestled, and it wasn't that it was my sport of choice. It was I had to do it because my brothers did it. And growing up, being the youngest of six, that gives you an advantage because you learn from their mistakes, and they're always pushing you to go harder. And I was just, you know, out of all my brothers, me being the youngest actually made me more prone to winning the gold medal. I became the best in the family, and that's what I done for. I just wanted to be as good as my brothers, and I actually became better.
Well, okay. All right, so fast forward. You got into WWF. What year and what were the circumstances are you coming in?
Well, after I won the gold medal, which, by the way, was the best moment of my life, you know, at the same time, the next day, it was the worst moment because I didn't know what the hell I was going to do. You know, I worked my whole life to be an Olympic gold medalist, and I really didn't think what I wanted to do afterward. I got a great college education. I was an education major. But I just wasn't ready to be a teacher, and I wanted to do something athletic, and I also wanted to get into acting. And the WWE was a great platform for me because, you know, it's a little bit of both. And, you know, you can be a character and you can show your athleticism. And Vince McMahon called me into his office right after the Olympics, and we had a deal on the table, but I refused at that time. A lot of my peers in amateur wrestling thought that it wouldn't be respectful to my sport.
Okay.
But after a couple of years, I realized it's not really you're not really taking a step above. You're actually taking a step over into sports entertainment. It's not really you can't really compare the two, and they're actually complete opposites. So far apart. So I decided I was going to do it, and as you can see, I had a lot of success. But a lot of guys after me followed: Brock Lesnar, Shelton Benjamin, Charlie Haas, Dolph Ziggler, Jack Swagger. So I gave amateur wrestlers another platform where they could, you know, show off their athleticism in a different light.
Okay. So you have had some of the most iconic matches in wrestling history, bar none. Is there any one or two that really just stick out to your mind as legendary?
Wow. I was really blessed to wrestle a lot of great wrestlers. In WWE, I mean, you look at guys like Shawn Michaels that were incredibly gifted. Brock Lesnar is an animal. The Undertaker. All of them. I mean, Stone Cold, The Rock, Triple H.
Right.
Chris Benoit. Wow. I never had a guy match my intensity but him. But, you know, when it's all said and done, you know, the WrestleManias are what it's all about, even though I've had better matches. Undertaker at No Way Out in 2006, Chris Benoit at the Royal Rumble 2003. But I'd have to say, because the WrestleManias, Shawn Michaels WrestleMania 21 and Brock Lesnar WrestleMania 19, there were some really special matches.
Well, what are some of the fundamental differences, in your opinion? I don't want to put you on the spot. But between the way TNA does business as opposed to the way Vince does business?
For me personally, it was another way for me to take my career. I really had a blast in WWE. Vince McMahon was great to me. We had a good run for 6.5 years, and, you know, for a good year of that, I was injured. So, you know, it was a little under 6 years where I really I did what I did, and, you know, in that short period of time, because I just started wrestling when I went on TV. I was only training for a few months. I don't think anybody's ever going to have that kind of success just starting out. I think I won the title within 10 months of when I started.
Right.
But it was – I really enjoyed working for Vince. The thing is, you know, my body, the full-time schedule just wasn't – it wasn't working for me. I had a lot of injuries, a lot of neck injuries, and they just kept coming back and coming back. And, you know, and I wanted to go part-time, and they really wanted me to be their workhorse and go full-time. So I didn't have much of an option but to ask for a release. And when I went to TNA, they gave me the schedule I wanted. And
okay.
They've been really loyal to me, and I've enjoyed wrestling there and wrestling some great wrestlers, Sting and AJ Styles, Samoa Joe, Bobby Roode, Bobby Lashley. I've actually had a better career in TNA than WWE, and, you know, a lot of hardcore WWE fans haven't watched a lot of my matches, but, you know, they would be pretty surprised to hear me say that, but it's really true. I had a better career, and I think I just got better, more experienced, and I was blessed enough to wrestle some really, really good athletes in TNA as well.
Okay, well, next Saturday, we have Glenn Kelly from Glenn Kelly Real Estate on with us. He wants to thank you in advance. Next Saturday, we're all going to be getting together at Seaside Heights, New Jersey, for the benefit. So, Glenn, take it away. Kurt Angle is on the phone.
Hey, Kurt, I got to tell you, it's just an absolute honor. I know we've been chatting and whatnot, putting this big, huge, mega charity event together. My heart goes out to you. Thank you so much for being a part of Eternal Tranquility and the dreams come true. Kids are going to be ecstatic to see you. Everyone's talking about it. Saturday, June 13th, noon to 4 at the Beachcomber Bar and Grill. I know it is just a true honor for myself, Glenn Kelly, and the company, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, to even be affiliated with someone as truly iconic as you. I remember going all the way back. I even love, you know, Oscar got his rapping that he does. I hate to bring it up, but I think one of the most funniest moments I've ever seen in your career, as I've been following since day one when you entered WWE, even in your TNA career, was when you did the rap-off with John Cena. That was absolutely one of the funniest moments I've ever seen on Raw history. It was really, really good.
I really enjoyed working in the WWE, and they let me show off my funny side. I had a really goofy side to me for a few years, and I really loved doing that. And I would have loved to continue it, but, you know, Vince McMahon wanted me to take a more serious approach, but I really enjoyed doing the funny stuff, the entertaining stuff. But I just want to tell you I'm very honored to do the Eternal Tranquility charity, and I know a lot of great wrestlers are going to be there. Mick Foley, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Jake the Snake, but a lot of great wrestlers, and I'm very honored to be a part of it.
It's absolutely my honor and my privilege to have you come out. I thank you again so much. I can't thank you enough. It's going to be, for me, it's a blessing to have you there. And I know Eternal Tranquility and Dreams Come True. I want to wish you the same thing. I can't wait to have you rolling up in the Glen County Real Estate Limo. We're going to treat you like a king. I cannot wait to see you on the 13th.
All right, I can't wait to be there. It's going to be June 13th, and it's New Jersey. And anybody that's listening, come by and stop by and say hi and get an autograph, take a photo. I'd be happy to do that.
All right, Kurt. Thanks a lot, my man.
Thank you, guys. Have a good night.
All right.
You too, my friend.
Now, I am sitting here, and I'm taking this all in. On June 4th, at 9:05 Eastern Time, Not Your Mama's Radio Show, Sir Mo, Dreamy Mimi, Felix, we have made history. I don't know what other podcasts do. I don't care. We have made history, and we are like halfway through. We have made history right now. I'm so stoked.
Absolutely.
I really am appreciative. I mean, it's been an iconic first hour, yeah.
We got to give Oscar and Glenn all the credit right there for setting this up, this mega all-star action-packed show that we've had so far. I'm just honored to be a part of it and just be sitting at the learning tree listening to these great legends.
Oh, man, I mean, I'm just, you know, I'm like Colt Cabana, Stone Cold. I'm like, yeah, eat your heart out. Y'all can talk to Vince McMahon one-on-one and everybody on you. I told you it was Legends Month, and we cramming all the legends around in one night.
I don't
even
think Colt Cabana's got you. I think you even took it. The show has already surpassed Steve Austin.
I just told you
I passed
Colt Cabana. That's what I just said.
You think the Colt Cabana show has anything to do with Men on a Mission? Men on a Mission put them to shame. That's this show right here, live. No show has all these greats on while at one night.
Glenn, I want to thank you. So I want to thank you for having this event and making this happen. You the man. I mean, you know. Well, we got some time, obviously, so we want to catch up with the prodigal son, Sir Mo. So what all happened down in Canada besides they tried to kill you? I mean, besides, you know, you got food poisoning.
I think we lost. Are you there, Mo?
Yeah. What happened besides they tried to kill you?
Besides, who tried to kill me?
In Canada, he was trying to poison you. So what else happened? You know, bring us up to speed.
Hey, man, it was a good time. I tagged with Harry Smith the entire trip. We actually roomed together one night, which was fun in itself.
It was fun in itself. Couldn't find no ring rat, so you and Harry Smith went to the room together, huh?
Yeah, okay. Anyway.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Let's just say we don't kiss and tell, buddy.
No, okay. Well, hey, I'm trying to tell you, we the room together. We the room together back in the day. We don't still have some money today.
Well, I don't know about all that.
Yeah, I do.
we the room together. We probably wouldn't be here talking today.
Now, you right about that. We'd have been there killing each other.
I probably would have put your fat ass out.
Yeah.
Trying to eat fried chicken 3 o'clock in the morning.
Who was the last one in the bathroom? Who cracked the damn toilet?
Uh-oh.
You?
Yeah, exactly. I'd have been like, yeah, Nelson did it.
Reunion of the Fat Boys, I tell you what.
No, dog, it wasn't me. I ain't even used the bathroom. I ain't touched the damn toilet.
No, dog, I didn't come here to make friends, dog.
I didn't come here to win no popularity contest, Vince.
I ain't come here to make no friends.
Man, shut your big ass up and you get us fired.
What a thing to say when your ass is getting fired. I didn't come here to make friends.
Really? Yeah, I hear that. Yeah, I didn't come here to make friends.
Woo. Oh, man.
All right, so back to you, Dreamy Mimi Gerard. So are you clear on the question that I wanted you to ask Lita when she come on? You got it?
Yes, I'm clear.
All right, because I didn't know if
she's
I
clear.
I don't know. I didn't know if I explained it right, because you know
crystal
I know how
clear.
I can be all over the place.
Yeah, she's crystal clear.
Okay, good.
Her mind is clear.
Good.
Crystal
good.
Clear.
Her mind is clear.
Crystal clear.
So, Glenn, you are going to roll a limo up and down the Jersey Shore next Saturday. You got it all cleaned out and ready?
I got it all cleaned out and ready for you, Oscar. You know that. You're going to be drafting it up all up and down the boardwalk. We know what time it is.
What year is that thing anyway? It looks brand spanking new.
Come on, baby. Brand spanking new for you, all lettered up. Glenn Kelly Real Estate all over it. The only real estate company with their own limousine. And I mean literally their own limousine. You're going to have a great time, baby. You're going to have a blast.
Well, you know, I mean, I saw a picture of that thing, and I said, I wonder if they're picking me up from the airport in that, because I have got to roll out. I'm going to have 1,000 Facebook pictures. I'm going to be under the thing, giving it a tire change. I'm going to be up under the hood, giving it a transmission job. I'm going to be all in the back seat, all on the hood.
Hey, guys, I want to let you know that we do have another WWE Hall of Famer joining us, the legendary Tito Santana.
Nice.
Ah, Tito Santana is in the building. Tito, I don't know if you know who I am. This is Oscar from Men on a Mission It Don't Matter. I am a super duper fan of yours, and I'm honored and glad to have you on my show. How are you, sir?
I'm doing fine. Thank you so much.
That is fantastic. Now, you are a legend from back in, when did your career start, in the late 70s or the 80s?
It started in 1977.
Mm-hmm. Okay, because I remember you're another alumni from when wrestling came on WOR-TV in New York, Channel 9 at midnight. Those legendary days with Grand Wizard of Wrestling, Lou Albano, Bruno Sammartino, the birth of Bob Backlund and all that, and the Hall of Fame ring you got is well deserved. Give us some great stories from back at from back then to start things off with. We're not going to keep you long. I just trying to get some history.
Well, I was just amazed. I came from Texas, and when I finally arrived into New York, here is a Mexican guy coming into Madison Square Garden. You know, it was just amazing to walk into that building. You know, it's the moment in my career that to me was an unforgettable moment. And just being around, you know, all these superstars like you were talking about. You know, Bruno Sammartino was still wrestling. You know, he was commentating and wrestling, and I had the honor of teaming up with him, you know, on a couple of occasions, and just the characters that they had, you know, the Wizard, Fred Blassie, and Captain Lou Albano, and, you know, it was just unbelievable to be, among all those stars.
Now, And I know that there are a lot. Was there a lot of just, you know, in the 90s, we had a lot of ribbon going on. Was there a lot of ribbon going on back in the 70s and 80s backstage back then? Just about old education.
Yeah, well, I mean, Mr. Fuji was a big time ribber, you know, but
he was a big ribber in the 90s. But go ahead.
Yeah, he would do some heavy time ribbing. You know, I remember if they didn't like somebody, you know, some of the ribs were not very nice ribs. Jerry Lawler went to wrestle and they brought the crown back to the dressing room, and when Lawler came back, he found out that somebody had pooped in the crown and discovered what had happened, and all of a sudden there's a meeting, you know, with Vince McMahon, and he kind of read us the right ass, you know, to stop ribbing, you know, but I don't think it stopped.
No, it didn't stop, and between me and you, Vince encouraged a lot of that stuff. He would say in front of everybody, you know, you guys need to cut it out. But he was laughing his ass off, you know, in a corner privately. So, yeah, that wasn't going to help. All right, so if you had to think of one or two iconic matches, who would they have been with?
Well, I had the longest feud in the WWF history with Greg the Hammer Valentine, and I used to love wrestling him. But the guy that I really, really enjoyed wrestling against was Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff. And I would say that the next best guy that I really enjoyed was Mr. Perfect.
Well, okay. Fantastic. All right, well, we've got Glenn Kelly. Next Saturday, you're going to be in New Jersey, Seaside Heights, for the big Eternal Tranquility benefit. We got Glenn Kelly on the phone of Glenn Kelly Real Estate. He's on to say thank you in advance and hype the event. Tito Santana's on the phone. Glenn, holla at him.
Hey, Tito, what's happening, baby? I know we've been talking for a while now, putting the show together. You've been a very, very intricate part in putting everything together. I know you do a lot of things for charity and whatnot. It's my honor for Glenn Kelly Real Estate, as well as Eternal Tranquility and Dreams Come True program, to welcome you June 13th, noon to 4, at the Beachcomber Bar and Grill in Seaside Heights. I know it's going to be iconic. I know it's going to be epic. To have someone of your caliber on the roster to come out along with everyone else is just absolutely phenomenal. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for making it possible to have a name like yourself be at our event and to really, really help us rev up the charity and whatnot. I really, really appreciate that.
Thank you so much, Glenn, and I'm looking forward to meeting all the fans. Hopefully they all come out and support the cause, and we all do good and have a good time in the meantime.
Yeah, I want to thank you so much, Mr. Santana, a true icon in wrestling history, going to be live not only on the biggest podcast radio show of all time, but also next Saturday at the Beachcomber. It's going to be my pleasure, Mr. Santana. I look forward to seeing you.
Thank you so much.
All right, we're going to see you next Saturday, Tito.
All right, brother. Arriba.
Arriba. All
Arriba,
right, now,
baby.
It was, now, people, it's not just about the wrestlers. It's also about the fans. Phil, so we have a 773 caller on?
We do, actually, yes.
Okay, we're going to bring Mr. Calvin King in from Free Lunch Academy, who's been listening, and I'm pretty sure has got to be stoked right now because he's a fan
man
of these legends. Calvin, man, you having a good time?
Dude, I'm beside myself, man. I'm like beside myself listening to this whole thing and just can't believe how many legends that you guys are bringing together for this amazing cause next week. That's hats off to you guys.
Yeah, man, it's an amazing cause. Glenn Kelly is definitely the man. I'm glad that everybody. Yeah, whatever. Hey, we're on the radio.
right. Let me move.
Hey, whoever that is. Hey, we're doing a radio show.
Good old
anyway.
Chicago joggers, man.
Oh, yeah. So, anyway, Yeah, I wanted to bring you in to see if you was having a good time because I know you a big fan. It's not just about us. It's about us bringing joy to the people that watch us. And me personally, if I were just listening to this show, I would just be like, oh, man, I remember I used to watch Dude when I was like 11 years old. And I mean, you're way younger than me. So I used to watch these cats when I was little. So I know how you must feel.
I like have the taste of Fruit Loops in my mouth right now because I remember sitting on the foot of the bed eating Fruit Loop Bowl after Fruit Loop Bowl, watching wrestling, and I was even telling you the other day when we spoke about I remember the ice cream truck would come through and all you guys were on the ice cream bars, man. Like, this is so nostalgic. So nostalgic.
You know, you're talking to a guy right now. Mo used to eat those things by the truckload. You remember those ice cream bars, Mo?
I remember.
Man, that was heaven on a stick.
It was good. I remember I saw Mo eat this stuff one day.
Yes, indeed. I remember y'all would come out here to the Rosemont Horizon.
It's the Allstate Arena now, but the Rosemont Horizon, that's it.
Hey, Oscar, Mo, I just want to let you know our next guest of honor is called in, and she's been a highly anticipated guest. Many have been calling in to listen to her talk tonight.
Okay.
She is Lita. We can bring her on whenever you're ready.
All right. We are ready. We are not going to keep the queen of it all waiting. Lita, my darling. How are you?
Man, better late than never, right?
I would have stayed on till midnight waiting for you, so you're not late. You're right on time. They tell me Lita's coming on. I got my sleeping bag, my no-dos, and everything up waiting for you to call, so you're right on time, honey. How you doing, and thank you for calling in.
I'm great. Sounds like a party over there.
We are having a blast. We're asking just a couple of questions, and we're hyping this event, so we're not going to keep you long. So to ask the question that we want to ask, we have our own Dreamy Mimi. Dreamy, you're all the leader. Ask that question we all want to know.
Okay. Hello, Lita. First, I wanted to say congratulations from you being a WWE Hall of Famer. And my question is, what differences do you see in yourself and other former female wrestlers and the WWE Divas today?
So what are the differences?
Yes.
I think the main thing today that I got to be a part of was, we got to mix up with the men a lot, and you don't really get to see a lot of that today. So that was something always exciting during the Attitude Era, that you never knew, who was going to kind of get crazy and start seeing things that you never got to see, that you don't get to see now. And that added a lot of depth to our character and stuff. But as far as talent-wise, I think the girls, are definitely, like, as talented and beautiful and athletic, but it's like a different time in wrestling how females are portrayed.
Okay.
Is that really true? Because it seemed to me, and I'm playing devil's advocate, it seemed to me when it comes down to you, Deborah Bocelli, Trish Stratus, you guys had more technical in-ring skill and took more chances, as you guys are more like female wrestlers as opposed to being divas. Would you say that that's a fair comment?
Man, I mean, I love hearing that. And definitely the thing with Trish and I, in that time, is we didn't necessarily consider ourselves divas. It was like just we were part of the roster. We were superstars along with everybody else. And
right.
Now it just seems like the divas are very, very separate from everybody else on the roster. And in one way, it's cool. It's like they've built this own diva brand. But in another way, it does kind of separate them, and it seems like the bar is not as high as it was back then,
In other words, what I'm trying to say is when watching Trish Stratus, you can see right then and there Hall of Fame, future Hall of Famer. And the things you did, the way the crowd popped when you did what you did, the way the crowd popped when you came out, and even your status and notoriety today. The Divas don't get – there's not one Hall of Famer on the Diva roster right now, and I'm just saying my opinion, the fans are not standing up going wild with their high spots and the things they do. That's the fundamental difference. Am I wrong?
Man, you're putting me on the spot here, aren't you? We're just like
in. I'm telling it like it is.
No, I mean, I pop in here and there, and I catch the show, and I watch it, and it is. It's, I feel like it's hard to dissect. So what's missing? What was more so much more exciting when you were watching us back in that day? And me watching it, I go, you know, I just like how we mix it up with the men, and is it part of it ability? Is it part of it the way that they're built? You know, to me, I mean, me not trying to be PC or not trying to not give you a quote, it's like I'll sit there and watch it, like as someone who's done it, going, what is it? What's missing? You know, and I mean, I'm sure anybody would love to have that answered because, you know, the guy, the writers and everybody making, trying to make a living off of this would love to know how to boost and like this hashtag give Divas a chance. While I think it's cool, another part of me is like, no, you go give yourself a chance, like make a chance, like get, show me something that I want to watch, and then I'm going to watch it, and then that's your chance right there.
Yeah, okay. The biggest question, I'm going to put you on the spot one more time. This is the biggest question of the night. A few weeks back, were you at the Fairmont? Because I was looking for you, and I didn't see you.
The Fairmont.
Yeah, during WrestleMania. Were you at the Fairmont Hotel? Because I looked there
for
you. I saw everybody else, but I didn't see you. It was so disappointing.
Well, you didn't look very. I had to take my dog out 2 or 3 times a day. I was all in and out of that place. Well, where were you?
Oh, okay. All right. I stayed at the Fairmont. So, and I was like, I saw everybody else, had a reunion with everybody else, but I'm like, well, where the hell is Lena? I couldn't miss them, those tattoos nowhere, but I didn't see you, honey.
I was by myself all week, man. I was needing someone to hang out with. I was looking for you.
I was knocking on rooms. I mean, Jesus.
We need like a secret, like, like a call.
Hey.
Okay, all right. Well, Dream Eagle is my wife. You're going to get me in trouble. I was like, you know, big brother, little sister kind of thing. But I'm going to find you next Saturday because we're going to be in New Jersey, Seaside Heights. So we definitely going to hang out next Saturday.
Oh, my God.
All right, you remember our call. Make sure that we find each other in this crowd.
I'm going to do it right when I walk in and see. Woo! Okay, Glenn Kelly is on the phone right now, and he wants to say hi and thank you for coming next Saturday. Glenn Lita's on the phone.
Lita, I just want to say, I think following the conversation from prior, what's missing today is you were a true icon. And out of all the divas, past, present, and future, that we could have had for the Eternal Tranquility show, everybody voted, let's get Lita. Lita's got some type of characteristic with her that she is truly iconic in every sense of the word. No diva, coming from me, no diva could match her. When she did her, when you did your high spots and whatnot, you were fabulous. And I don't think there's another, in my opinion, another female athlete, even presently today, that had the technical capabilities to do the moves that you did. It is an honor and a privilege as a 30-year, I've been watching wrestling for 30 years and following it and doing mega charity events with wrestlers and whatnot, and to have someone like yourself come out, Brandon, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, Eternal Tranquility, Dreams Come True, it's an absolute blessing to even have you on the podcast. And it's a blessing to have you come out. We're going to treat you like royalty. You deserve it. And you gave the fans some of the best matches that they'll ever see. A women's match is hands down the best matches they'll ever see. You were and still are truly the icon.
Well, thanks so much for having me. And, you know, it's been fun doing these appearances because while, you know, the fans, we get to experience each other in a different way when I'm wrestling matches. Now to be able to, like, say it face-to-face. You know, we have this time to be able to talk and chat and shake hands and take pictures together. And, you know, it's like it's a totally different level, a new chapter of being able to get on a different level with fans that grew up with me.
Well, wow. This is go ahead, Glenn. I'm just...
I'm sorry, Oscar. I was just going to say that this event of this magnitude, live at the Beachcomber Saturday, June 13th, noon to 4, Oceanfront. It's an unbelievable venue. Lita, you're going to love it. It's going to be absolutely spectacular. I'm looking forward to when the public event is over so we can sit down. You and Oscar can reminisce a little bit over some good dinner on me. It's going to be a great, great event. Dreams come true. The children with the impairments and the disabilities and whatnot are going to absolutely, they're already going nuts to even know that you're in the house, let alone meet you. You're truly an icon, and again, it's a blessing for me not only to even speak to you on this largest podcast ever that me and Oscar are putting together here tonight, but to have you in Seaside, it's just an honor and a blessing. Truly thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Cal, thanks so much. I'm really looking forward to it, hanging out with everybody for the day, so we'll see you guys soon enough.
All right, Lita, thank you for coming. I appreciate it. Love you. See you next Saturday. Hoo-hoo!
Hoo-hoo!
Okay. Hey, Dreamy?
Yes?
I know you'll get a hold of me later, right?
You're okay.
Okay, hey, Dreamy, let me ask you a question.
Yes?
As executive producer of this company, how do we top this show moving forward? I just want to know. I don't know.
We'll have to discuss it later.
Are you having a good time?
Yes, I am.
Are you impressed?
Yes, I am.
Okay, well, be impressed with Glenn Kelly, because he's the architect of this. I'm just the facilitator. Glenn, you have impressed
hey
my wife. Yes, oh, wait a minute, wait, there's more. Because when Felix goes, hey, guys, that means something good's about to happen. Yes, Felix,
yes.
What can we do for you?
Yes, yes, yes. TNA superstar Robbie E joins us live.
Well,
again,
you
baby.
See,
again.
Yeah, well, you see, the hits just keep on coming. Robbie E, what's up, brother man?
Hey, I just want to say I was listening to you guys talk to Lita, and I hope, I mean, you're going to buy her dinner. I hope you guys buy me dinner, too.
I got you, baby.
As long as I'm getting dinner, we're off to a good start. What's up, guys?
No, okay. Well, you heard that, Glenn. Robbie E, we got to feed. We got to feed Robbie
this
E.
This is what I want to see. I want to see Robbie E, TNA superstar icon, step out. You know the $1 million man is going to be there, but he's not the $1 million realtor. That's Glenn Kelly. And I want to see Robbie E. stepping out of the Glenn Kelly real estate limo. That's what I want to see. And then he gets
well,
the center,
happen.
Baby.
That's going to happen, and I'm pumped for it. And that's why, right when I heard about this event, Seaside, I'm from Jersey. It was a no-brainer. I had to be a part of it. So I'm super pumped, and I'm excited for next week.
Nice.
We have had some superstars on this stage here tonight, but Robbie E, like Run used to say, this is my house. What's going on, Robbie?
Well, I'm feeling good. Like I said, Glenn Kelly's running this huge event in Jersey. I'm from Jersey, so I just had to be a part. But why don't you guys tell me what should I expect when I come to it?
Glenn, take it away.
I think what we're going to do with the dreams come true charity event together with Eternal Tranquility and of course myself, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, it's going to be one of, I'm telling, mark my words, the most iconic charity event of all time. Especially when you got guys that are homegrown. This is a New Jersey-based charity, and you got Robbie E from Jersey coming down for this. This is going to be an amazing charity event. Everybody's going to want to get their picture and autograph with Robbie E and all the other talent. Picture the boardwalk, Seaside Heights, June 13th, Saturday, noon to 4, live on B98.5 Radio, live on 5 podcasts worldwide. It's going to blow up. Plus, we're giving away $5,000 worth of freebies that people could enter to win that go from gift certificates to memberships to baskets. It's going to be off the hook. And it's my pleasure to have you come down, Robbie. It really is.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. I'm not the only person from TNA because Kurt Angle's coming also, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Kurt Angle was on the show earlier, yes.
Oh, nice. What did he have to say? Is he excited for it?
Oh, come on, Kurt. I talk with Kurt a lot. Kurt is so excited. He's so hyped up for this event, just for the charitable aspect alone with it. He's in another dimension to come out. I mean, if you check Kurt's website and whatnot, he doesn't do a lot of special appearances off the side. He's basically doing a really good favor and whatnot, and bless his heart, man. He's got a heart of gold, and I'm really looking forward to seeing him come out for the event.
And Robbie, if that's not enough, at 2:30 in the morning, there's going to be a knock on your hotel room door, and there's going to be a big black Barry White looking bastard in a red robe, and what happens in Seaside Heights stays in Seaside Heights. How's that going?
Oh, damn. Okay.
I don't even know how to comment on that. But I do agree. What happens if Seaside Heights stays in Seaside Heights, that's for sure. I think all of us would be in trouble if we've admitted what's happened there.
Oh, there you go. Oh, man, no, it's going to be great. We asked one question. What's the highlight of your TNA career thus far? What are your greatest matches? Give us a good one.
I think the highlight of my career is, I'm proud to say that I was a former X Division television and two-time TNA tag champion, but I think the second time that me and my partner, the Bromans, well, we won the tag titles in Tokyo, Japan, that was a huge accomplishment for us. So I'm pretty sure when you ask that question, that stands out the most.
All right. And isn't Japan just a fantastic place to wrestle?
Oh, it's awesome. I think Glenn should hold his next event there.
Don't get me started, Robbie, because you know Glenn Kelly Real Estate now licensed New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Florida. Do not make me go to Tokyo, Japan, because it will happen, baby.
Let's go worldwide.
You, Glenn Kelly, you sell condominium. You sell condominium. You sell mini condominium. We love you long time. All right,
never
Robbie.
We're
gonna see you next Saturday. We all getting together. It's gonna be a big family reunion. Can't wait to see you. I'm meeting you for the first time, so that's gotta be awesome. So yay, we doing it for a good cause, doing it for charity next Saturday.
All right, I'll be there. Looking forward to it. Thanks, guys.
All right, thank you so much, Robbie.
I gotta let you know. And we're still going. We're still going strong. The final guest of the evening, or maybe not, the one and only WWE legend, Tatanka.
Nice.
Hey, guys. What's up, Oscar, man on a mission? How you doing, Glenn Kelly?
Welcome to Tatanka.
No, he can't be on my show. What's up, Chris? Tatanka's on the phone.
I'm doing fantastic, man. Matter of fact, just coming back from pumping steel at Gold's Gym. I'm excited about coming up to the event again at the Beachcomber Bar and Grill, Seaside Heights, New Jersey, this upcoming Saturday, June the 13th, the Native American Tatanka, and some of the greatest names in our business. You guys were just talking about it. Olympic gold medalist Kurt Angle. I was listening to Lita, too. I'd love to talk about the conversation about what you guys were talking about, how things have changed in our business. So Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Jake the Snake Roberts, a lot of the guys I see on the road right now, Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. I just seen Tito Santana just a couple weeks ago, so I'm real excited about coming up to the event. And again, the Eternal Tranquility Charity. It's always awesome to be involved in an event where it's just not for yourself, that you're truly giving back to those in the area and those that who are truly in need.
Beautiful.
Well, we got plenty of time now, so we can have a discussion. Because we go way back. Mo, get in here, because you know we go back with this man. You came in. How big of an influence was T.J. Strongbow on your character?
Oh, my God. Well, he tremendous influence, of course, because, as you knew, at that time, Oscar, Chief J. Strongbow was the man who was right next to, as we called him then, Caesar, Vince McMahon. and Pat Patterson. So Chief J. Strongbow had a lot of influence as far as things that happened on TV and things that happened throughout the year corporately for WWE. What was so great about my character, truly being Native American from the Lumbee tribe, full blood Lumbee tribe of North Carolina, also I'm family to the Lakota Sioux. So what they loved is my character was truly who I was. So Vince McMahon started right from my tribal land, from Pembroke, North Carolina, where we actually filmed from very sacred events, where actually our shaman, our holy man, was dancing around me with an eagle feather and preparing me to come into the WWE. So it was an honor, because as I came in, here you had this great superstar, no other than Chief J. Strongbow, to be not only my mentor, but to be the one right there talking events and saying, hey, we need to do this, we need to do that. Matter of fact, I was just speaking to a judge yesterday, having a conversation, and he reminded me of the angle back in, I forget when it was, approximately, I think he said 1960, somewhere right around there, and he talked about Chief J. Strongbow and Ernie Ladd, and the big angle with Ernie Ladd and Chief J. Strongbow, where he took his sacred headdress, ripped it up, stuffed it in his mouth, stuffed it down his trunks. Well, guess what? The influence of Chief J. Strongbow, how great that was, because we did the same storyline with Erwin R. Scheister, IRS, saying the Native American Tatanka got a free gift, which we did on WWE. Chief J. Strongbow was there. Wahoo McDaniels passing the torch to me. And a member of my tribe, Ray Little Turtle. I got that sacred headdress. And as you know, eventually down the road, IRS, with the assist of Quang, spraying that liquid that he would spray in everybody's eyes, just like Muta, he actually blinded me, got my headdress, tore it up, the same storyline as Chief J. Strongbow. It was very successful because me and IRS ran all over the world for a whole year with that storyline and that angle.
Something happened with that headdress that night that really made Chief hot. Do you remember what that was? Because I caught the tail end of it. He was cursing with Vince and something. They actually made y'all do the spot over. Do you remember what I'm talking about? Because something happened with that. Because he took that headdress situation real serious. That's my point.
Well, he took it very seriously. What was great about Chief J. Strongbow was the storyline that we showed on TV was perfect. But what he was talking about during that time, he wanted to make sure that something so sacred that it wasn't played with, meaning with a Native American, with a true Native, we just don't give each other a headdress. A headdress is earned. Each feather is earned. It's not the whole headdress that is earned. Each feather is earned. There is great honor, either chiefs, or there has to be some great honor that's been bestowed upon you to be able to wear a war bonnet, to be able to wear things of this nature. Native Americans don't walk around wearing a headdress. Again, it's regalia. It's involved with a ceremony. Same thing is maybe to relate it when people go into a church event, how they dress that are part of the leadership is sometimes they dress different. Well, same thing with the natives when it's something that is a ceremony that they believe there's one great spirit. Well, they only wore headdresses at those times in ceremonies or going into war or wore bonnets. So he wanted to make sure that it was portrayed right and it wasn't portrayed something cartoonish. And it's one thing that Vince McMahon did all the way through. He never did anything funny or, what do you want to say, cartoonish with my character.
Okay, because it's funny you mentioned the word cartoon, because I asked Chief one day, I said, what is different? This was during our time. What is different, the fundamental difference between wrestling now and the way it was back then? And he looked at me and said, today, it's like a fucking cartoon. And when he said that, I mean, I was rolling. I almost swallowed my tongue. Not that he said it looked like a cartoon, but just the way he said it. That man was hilarious.
Oh, yes, he was. You remember how he would stand there, Oscar, and he would tuck his hands behind his back, and he would be rocking like his hands were in a parade rest, and how he would have his head up, and how he was tall. Chief was just great to be in the locker room. What was so great about that era, and I know that you're also there, Glenn, what was so great about that era, everywhere I go, I'm busy all the time. I travel all
right.
over the world, not only coming here next week, but then after that I go to the United Kingdom. After that, I'm in Mass. I just came back from the Mass in New York area doing TV. Everywhere I go, the fans, no matter what, they love the eras from the 80s and the 90s. The reason
yep.
why everyone had character, everyone was unique, everyone was totally different. No one came out like they do today with boots, tights, and just knee pads and all looking similar. Every single guy, Men on a Mission. No one looked like Men on a Mission. No one looked like the Native America Tatanka or Hulk Hogan or the Legion of Doom or Barbarian or Warlord or British Bulldog Smith or, I mean, everybody, Bret the Hitman Hart, Shawn Michaels, Undertaker. As you go down the names, no one looked the same. Everyone was unique. Everyone was a superstar. And everyone portrayed their characters who they were. When you look at TV today, the greatest things that are making the hundreds of millions of dollars are all the characters. People love to get away from that reality and fall in love with those characters. The Hulk, Captain America, Batman, Spider-Man, some of the biggest movies in history are animated movies because people love the characters. Star Wars, billions of dollars. So again, what's missing in our business is having the characters, having the great storylines, and having the storylines truly written by someone with wrestling knowledge as compared to someone who's came out of college thinking he knows how to write a wrestling story. During that day, as you knew, Oscar, we had Chief Chase Strongbow and we had also Pat Patterson, two very successful wrestlers that made tons of money wrestling, so they understood wrestling. Not like today. We got guys out of college and they think they know how to write, and that's the reason we have the terrible storylines that we have today.
Yeah, well, you had Tony Garea, you had Rene Goulet.
Of course.
Mo, you're there. Do you remember the funniest question that Mabel ever asked me and you about Chief J. Strongwell?
No, I don't recall. What, are you speaking to me, Oscar?
No, this is Mo, and I wanted you to hear this.
Yeah.
Mabel just out the clear blue, we was in the car, and he said, is it me or Chief's stomach getting bigger? And I mean, we was rolling.
Chief, man, I miss him. I spoke to him several different times, you know, throughout the years, and I spoke to him when he was actually, you know, I gave him a call and when he was in Georgia, when he wasn't doing that well, and spoke to his wife, and, you know, he really couldn't talk that much, but, you know, I spoke to him and just gave my regards and told him how much I appreciated him, how much I was so thankful for what he did for me, again, at War Wrestling Federation. So, yeah, he's someone who is definitely greatly missed. You know, Wahoo McDaniels in our business, another guy that started me that was there at the beginning was, again, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat, one of the best baby faces in our business. He, you know, he really helped me so much because I started in the North Carolina area, running the North Carolina territory for 5 days a week with TV, with George Scott's promotion, South Atlantic Pro Wrestling, then changed to the North American Wrestling Association. One of my top matches there, and who I fought all the time, and we really fought because I came from playing football from the area, remember the Titans, college scholarship. So when I met this guy and we got in the ring, all we did was just beat each other up. Ken Shamrock was the guy that I started the business with in the North Carolina, South Carolina, Virginia area.
Yep. No, okay. Mo, you want to talk to Tucker?
Yeah. Hey, Chris, how you doing?
Good, man. How's everything?
Man, everything's great. Everything's great. And always been a big fan, even back in the North Carolina days when you used to – You personified what a babyface was to me back in those days, because you were one of the guys that got out and actually went and hit the towns and went out and promoted the towns and talked to sponsors and all that. I think if not for some of the work that you did, some of those South Atlantic shows would have been in the toilet, man.
Well, you're so right. If you remember back in the day too, you know, even before us, when we started, this is the way that we were all brought into the business. We understood about respect. We understood about working the towns. We understood about the baby faces, working the towns, working the fans, being what he's supposed to be, a baby face, being liked by the fans, you know, spending time with the fans, spending time in your market, you know. So, yes, some of those events, for example, when I wrestled Ken Shamrock for the title, it was actually in my tribal lands. It was actually in Pembroke, North Carolina. I actually went to that town every single week on sponsorship packages because we were doing TV. I went with a local native there that knew all the business people. I went around the town myself on several trips, leaving Charlotte, going to Pembroke, North Carolina, staying a few days there, working, going to every business, everyone, all the radio. I actually raised $10,000 myself for that one show when I wrestled Ken Shamrock. So, yeah, it helped me so much because when you get in the market and you're letting everyone know about the wrestling event, when you're letting everyone know about all the great stars that are coming, you're also letting them know about yourself. So it's great advertisement, and it really helped me because 1 year later, after starting the business, 1 year later I was signed by World Wrestling Federation.
Right. Exactly right. Yeah, it was a crazy time back then. I remember there was a show in Cherokee, North Carolina, that Manny wanted Nelson and I to drive that raggedy-ass U-Haul truck. And we had to go down to South Carolina to this guy's house and pick up a ring. Man, and this ring, I don't even know if you can call it a wrestling ring. It was just horrible, man.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah,
yeah. I remember Manny. But that's what was so great about when we were there. What was so great about that actual promotion? They really had some funding. They really did know what they were doing. George Scott really had a smart mind. He also was very influential in that North Carolina territory, setting it up and being involved in it. So it was great because we were running 4 to 5 times a week. So we got a lot of work. We were able to learn the business quick. But, yeah, I know what you're talking about as far as going out and getting rings, sometimes not having the best ring. That's the reason WWE is absolutely so awesome when you actually get there, because the rings and everything that you're involved with is top of the line.
Oh, yeah. It's like a whole different world. You go, it's like you walk into this time warp where you're used to working in these rings that's got 50 million potholes in it, to working in these rings that's solid and hard as a rock. You know, it's just a totally different atmosphere.
I agree. Well, you know, it's going to be absolutely awesome to see all you guys. I mean, you know, what's really cool about this charity, the New Jersey organization, it's pretty cool because a lot of the things they're talking about, meditation, yoga, relaxation, you know, stress, helping people, drug problems, I mean, body, mind, and spirit. It's a lot of things that the native people speak about, you know.
Exactly.
Promoting the wellness of oneself, you know, and it's always great when you have someone out there that is truly involved in things like this. Too many times in our everyday life, you know, we're only concerned about me, myself, and I, and we always bypass those who are in great need, that either need an encouraging word or either need to hear, hey, you can do it, or either let them know you can get through this, or actually be there financially for them. You know, charities are many different things. It's just not financially. It can be a loving, kind word. So it's absolutely awesome to be involved in events like this. So it's going to be awesome again to be involved with this event June the 13th from the Beachcomber Bar and Grill in Seaside Heights, New Jersey. Again, you know, having someone involved, again, Glenn Kelly, and bringing all of his expertise from his business, being in the real estate business, his awesome to bring all these great stars together again. Gold medalist Kurt Angle, Lita. It was awesome to hear her. I've seen her on the road just recently. Hacksaw Jim Duggan, USA. You know, Hacksaw is such an awesome guy. Every time I get on the road with him, we're absolutely laughing all the time. He's absolutely just a great guy. Jake the Snake Roberts, it's awesome to see him. I've been spending a lot of time. Great to see that he's doing awesome, and he's made that turn finally, and we just want to, you know, wrap our arms around him and stay tight with Jake, but he's been doing great, and it's excited to see that Mick Foley's going to be there. Again, my manager, when I did the big heel turn and said, Lex, you sold out? No, it was Tatanka and the $1 million man, Ted DiBiase. Jimmy, Superfly Snuka, it's going to be great to see him. Again, Men on a Mission, a lot of great memories. I mean, tremendous memories, because, again, we were there doing the beginning of something that was awesome. But it's so awesome to be part of an era, the 90s and even the 80s. I didn't start to the 90s, but to be a part of an era that will never, ever, ever be forgotten, because it represents an era that is not being showed today. And I tell you right now,
absolutely,
if the fans had an opportunity, if they had a choice, if there was an alternate program, I tell you, if there was a program out there of that nature, there would be a lot of people tuning in.
Oh, don't make Lynn Kelly Real Estate make that happen. Do not make
let me tell you something, Lynn Kelly.
Do not make me
Yeah, well, let me tell you something. I was sitting here, and I was doing some research on you, and I said, real estate tycoon. I said, well, I cannot wait to speak to you, because, like I said, again, being Native American, but what I've done in this business, natives all over the world speak to me. It's very humbling, because when you're at WWE, you're running. You don't get an opportunity to even think about the fans. It's from one city to another city. It's double shots on weekends. It's 300 days a year, every year. But what's been awesome is to be involved with the fans and also to be spending time with natives and see the impact, but more important, to speak to chiefs of major tribes, to speak to chiefs that have, you know, not only billion-dollar entities, the tribe itself, but billion-dollar entities they own. So, Glenn Kelly, I'm a lot further than what you actually think, what I'm talking about here. I'm looking forward to having a private talk with you. It's going to be a very exciting talk. One of my closest friends is the chief of the Seminole tribe. The Seminoles own the actually Hard Rock brand. They're not using that name. They bought that brand. That brand is theirs. They are my personal friends. I hang out with the chief. I fly in the corporate helicopters over Big Cypress. I've been down there many, many times for several different reasons. So, Glenn Kelly, we're going
to
sit down, real estate tycoon, and we're going
to
have a great
meeting.
That's
what I'd like to hear. That's what I'd like to hear, Chris. I'm
looking
forward to it, my friend.
Yeah, and again, you know, we really appreciate you. It's awesome to have an organization like yourself that has been successful and realizes, hey, you know, there's something greater than just success for myself. You know, how much can you have? How much cars can you have? How many houses can you have? But at the end of the day, when you go to bed, you have peace knowing that, hey, I'm looking to help someone else. Whatever that is, whatever that calling is for each and every one of us, you know, the true happiness is when you look past yourself and say, hey, let me do something for others. And it gives a great satisfaction. So I commend you for the Eternal Tranquility charity that you have for mind, body, and soul. Again, I'm looking forward to this awesome event. Everyone listening, June 13th, 2015, next week, Saturday, Beachcomber Bar and Grill, Seaside Heights, New Jersey. A lot of action. It's going to be awesome. Guys, some of the greatest superstars are there. The Native America Tatanka will be on a war dance for sure. So I'm looking forward to seeing everybody. Glenn Kelly, I am definitely looking forward to sitting down and having a private meeting with you also.
And that conversation,
my pleasure.
That conversation that conversation starts with, if you give everybody in a tribe a condominium, I will, and then he's filling the blanks.
Hey, you know what? It's funny. You drive through the Seminole lands, and when you're driving through the glades, you know, because the Seminole tribe is a very successful tribe. They're the only tribe in history that never signed a peace treaty. So because of that, it gave them great power with the United States government. When the soldiers came to get them, they actually went out in the swamps, and because of the alligators, the snakes, and the mosquitoes, and the Seminoles knowing how to live in that environment, they just said, forget it. So they never signed a peace treaty. And because of that, it's really given them, you know, some tremendous, tremendous strength, you know. So, but it's funny when you said that, because when you're driving through the Summerlands and the Everglades, because the tribe gives them money back, dividends from all the casinos that they have, the Hard Rocks. So all the natives, depending upon the blood of their tribe, they get a certain percentage. I know native kids who are full-blood Seminole, they get $15,000 a month. Plus, they could still work, do whatever they want to. So as you drive through some of the lands,
I'm sorry,
you see,
I'm sorry, would you repeat that? They get what?
They get $15,000 a month just for being full-blood Seminole. But when you drive through some of the lands, you see all these big brand-new trucks, and you see all these ATVs, you see all these nice cars.
I got some Cherokee in my blood. How much do I get?
There you go. Let me tell you, my good friends up there at O'Hara's in Cherokee, North Carolina, matter of fact, something else we need to speak about, Glenn Kelly. My friends there actually in Maggie Valley, which is right there by Cherokee, they've been speaking to me about some things. I've had some business meetings with them, but Cherokee is a beautiful area, man. You got Cherokee blood in you, that's absolutely awesome, because if you've been in Cherokee, North Carolina, what a gorgeous area. It's just beautiful to go through those mountains, that nice fresh river falling through you, all the great shops and trade outlets there. It's just beautiful. O'Hara's, the casino is absolutely gorgeous.
Look at this. Glenn Kelly comes on my show, and he gets $10 million wampum talking at the bunker. This is something else tonight.
Let me tell you something. Nobody puts a show together, and this show tonight, nobody puts a show together tonight like Glenn Kelly Real Estate.
Yeah,
you know what I'm talking about,
Eddie. See that.
And we have put together, thanks to Tatanka and all of our iconic superstar guests, the greatest, probably the most watched, listened to podcast of all time tonight. Guaranteed. Guaranteed.
Yeah, it didn't come free. The Tatanka going to get you $5 million in Indian money with the Hard Rock and the Seminoles. You know what the hell you
are. Oh, yeah. We're definitely going to talk, my friend, for sure. And it's definitely going to be an awesome, awesome event. When you got guys of the nature and ladies of the nature that you're bringing, this is going to be a huge event. Again, you got nothing but superstar names that are on this card. And again, Glenn Kelly, hats off to you again. I mean, not only have you promoted a fantastic event, but you're promoting it for a great cause, a great reason. And I agree. What an awesome podcast. You got Lita. You got Kurt Angle. You got Been on a Mission. You got the Native American Tatanka. You got all these great stars as being involved in an event. I mean, that's powerful just to be able to put that together. So I commend you. Hats off to you, my friend.
Thank you so much. I look forward
Thanks
to seeing
a
you.
Lot
it's a blessing. True, it's a true blessing to have you come out to the event on June 13th. I can't wait to sit with you personally and chat with you off the record and whatnot as well, my friend.
Yeah, thank you, Glenn. It's a pleasure, everyone. Again, fans, make sure you don't miss it. Next Saturday, June the 13th, we're going to be live from the Beachcomber Bar and Grill in Seaside Heights, a beautiful view overlooking the ocean. Guys, come out. You get an opportunity to chat with us. You get an opportunity to get autographs. Guys are going to be bringing T-shirts, all kinds of things. A lot of these proceeds are going directly to the charity. So, guys, make sure you come. Make sure it's jam-packed at Seaside Heights. You're going to have to call the police. Too many people. Too many people. Jam-packed. Get everyone there. Guys in that area, New Jersey, support a good cause. Show up because, again, anytime you're helping someone else, not only does it make you feel great, but you're going to have a great time. You get to see great superstars. Enjoy your day. I understand we have a private party afterwards, so I'm pretty sure Glenn Kelly is really taking it to the max, and it's going to definitely be a VIP party.
You got that right. I couldn't have said it better myself, baby. This guy is going on the Glenn Kelly payroll right here.
Well, we appreciate you guys. You guys have an awesome night. It's an honor, a true honor to be on here. Glenn, it's a true honor to speak to you again. Thank you for allowing me to be part of your event. I really look forward to you again. Truly, hats off to you for putting together such a great event for helping others. Guys, we really appreciate you. Native America Tatanka, looking forward. We're going to see you next Saturday.
Thank you very much, Tatanka. Thank you, my friend.
You're welcome, guys. Peace. You guys have a great night, okay?
All right. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. My pleasure. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Whew.
Amazing, baby. Amazing.
I don't know about nobody else, but I'm exhausted.
Wow. You know what? Can I ask you a question, Mr. Kelly?
Yes. Yes, sir.
I got to ask, would you ever consider bringing an event to the West Coast? Because now I'm like really jealous that I can't be there. I would love to go to one of those events out here on the West Coast. If that ever does happen in your future, would love to have one out here in California.
I was going to say, one good thing is we always do at least 2 to 3 rip big, just like this event, charity events. It's all about just what Chris was saying, Tatanka was saying is true.
Sure.
You know, I'm blessed to have been very, very successful in real estate, and I always give back. I mean, look at a thing like this, it's costing $40,000, and we just give back, and that's what it's all about, giving back to your community. And we will try.
Sure.
We're always doing charity events, so who knows? You may see Glenn Kelly Real Estate Limo roll up in California. It may happen. I can't say it won't.
All right. Sounds good.
It was a super show, a super show. If it's okay with you, Oscar, I'd just like to rattle off a couple of names that are helping put this event together.
Oh, yeah, go right ahead.
Yeah, I just want to, we have a host of sponsors that are, even though my company, Glenn Kelly Real Estate, is actually putting the whole event together and paying for the whole event, the list, real quick, that I just want to ramble through, are actually sponsors that are going to be giving away, when I said prior, $5,000 worth of stuff. People could come in for free and raffle a chance to win. These guys are making it all possible. Lacey Cleaning, Vanguard Funding, Patriot Title, B98.5 Radio, Capri Pizza, McGregor Training and Fitness, Retro Fitness of Tom's River, Feldman and Feldman Architects, Sundays the Ice Cream Place, Chasmataz Formal Wear of Tom's River, RS Fitness, K&K Building and Remodeling, Check Mix Boxing Center, Ocean County Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Center, Hamilton Radio, Ryan's Catering, New York City Glitz, Kuflick Dermatology, Sports Clips of Tom's River, Marquee Cinemas of Tom's River, Yo Factor Frozen Yogurt of Tom's River, Subway, Tom's River Hotel, ASAP Multimedia, Diesel Subs, and we even got gift cards from the big boys, Home Depot, Pizza Hut, Wawa. I'm telling you, this event is going to blow people's minds away. I mean, to be able to come out and have a chance to win $5,000 worth of freebies and whatnot is just absolutely, truly iconic. It's going to be an amazing show.
Well, I want to take the time out to say thank you to all those sponsors for putting everything together with you and having us. And, you know, just giving back to the people. You know, when businesses do that, it's a beautiful thing when a whole bunch of minds come together on a spiritual plane and they're able to do it. Glenn, I can't thank you enough for putting this together and helping this show be, you know, I've got to be one of the greatest podcasts. And I don't know who's done anything like this or whoever will again. I mean, I can't even, usually this is the time where I'd be like, well, next Thursday we're going to have the, I don't know what the hell we're going to do next Thursday.
How are you going to top it?
Yeah, exactly. I mean,
it's
going
to be hard. It's going to be hard to top a show that, in my mind, I'll say it, not you, but in my mind, the show that we did tonight surpassed even Stone Cold Steve Austin's show. I said it before. I think you became the iconic premier podcast of all time tonight. I think if it wasn't done before, tonight, it's hard to top a show when you got so many talent on a 2-hour show. You did an amazing job. Hats off to you. Thank you so much for dedicating the time to the Eternal Tranquility and Dreams Come True, and also Glenn Kelly Real Estate. You did a blast. And we're going to have a great time next week, man. We are going to have a blast.
Man, the only thing I can do to top it is we all going to show up and make the event what we promised it that we were going to be.
Oh, it's going to be great. I can't wait. Everybody out there listening, you got the best podcast of all time. Oscar teaming up with Glenn Kelly Real Estate. We did it. We put on the best show of all time, buying, selling, leasing, renting, glennkelly.com, GLENKELLY.com, or you can call us 732-244-0567. Glenn Kelly Real Estate. Not only are we tackling and taking over the real estate industry, but we got it here live. What a blast. I had a blast, and I want to thank you so much for having me on, baby.
And with that, the fastest 2 hours of radio has come again. This has been an amazing show. I want to thank our guest, Glenn Kelly, first of all, for helping us tie this together. We want to thank Tatanka, Lita, oh my God, Robbie E., Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Jake the Snake, the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. Who am I leaving out? Kurt Angle. Wow.
Jimmy Snuka.
Superfly, Jay Snooker, on behalf of Sermo, Dreamy Mimi, Felix Almeida, our crack producer, want to thank him, Calvin King calling in, can't forget him. See y'all next Thursday, maybe. Good night.
Good night,
night guys.
We're on a mission!